Hi, I'm Ken Freeman, Allen Question Professor and Dean of the Boston University School of Management, and today we have the opportunity to engage in dialogue with John Ryan, retired Vice Admiral from the U.S. Navy, former Chancellor of the State University of New York System, former Superintendent of the U.S. Naval Academy, and now the President and CEO of the Center for Creative Leadership, one of the world's most renowned centers for executive development. And as we move forward, let's turn right to John. John, tell us a little about yourself and your journey in leadership.
Hi, Ken. Well, I'm a work in progress. As you mentioned, I spent 35 years in the Navy, about 7 years in higher education, and now the last 5 years at the Center for Creative Leadership. I think leadership is a journey, and I'm on that journey. I'm trying to get better every day, but I just spent some time with your midshipmen, and it's inspiring to think that at some point I was that young. I look back on those experiences and I'm grateful for them, and I'm grateful for the opportunity that I have now to lead the Center for Creative Leadership.
What led you in the first place to pursue a military career?
Well, my mother and father just passed away in the last 3 or 4 years, but this was the only fight that I've ever seen them have. My mother wanted my twin brother and I to go to Princeton. And of course, this was during the Vietnam conflict, and we were both great basketball and baseball players, or at least we thought we were. And my dad thought that we could also get a great education at a place like West Point or the Naval Academy, but maybe also begin to learn how to be a leader. And so we went to both places, and we both wanted to fly airplanes, so we ended up making my dad happy and my mother worried. And as a matter of fact, at the Naval Academy, you go down in the summer, and you have a transition. They cut your hair, at that time I still had hair, and put on a uniform and go through some things. And then at the end of the day, you take the oath of office, and then you have 15 minutes with your parents. And we were talking to my parents, and I guess we took more than 15 minutes, and somebody came up and said, "Hey, you two guys, you're late, get back over here." And my parents lived in Pennsylvania. My dad said it was the longest 5-hour ride that he'd ever taken, because here my mother was seeing her little twin sons yelled at by someone. But it turned out to be a great opportunity for us, and 35 years went pretty quickly.
And as you went through your career, obviously a wonderfully successful career in the military, you made a major shift to go from the military into the academic world. How did that go for you? How did it come about?
Yeah. Well, I was at I was a 3-star officer, which is like a vice admiral in the Mediterranean, in charge of all our land-based aircraft and all our bases in Europe. And I got sent back to brief in the Pentagon on how the war in Bosnia was going, the conflict in Bosnia. And I talked to the chief of naval operations, who's the big shot in the Navy. And he said, "John, we want you to be the president or the superintendent of the Naval Academy." I said, "I really don't think I'd be a good superintendent. Could I do something else?" And he said, "Well, I want you to think about it." So I told a story that I told Kathy about, but to make a long story short, I started thinking about this and saying, okay, yeah, maybe I'd be a good example to midshipmen of what not to do in your first 2 years at the academy, and then maybe do some good things. So I actually took that job, and I was privileged to be the superintendent for 4 years, and it turned out it was a great experience. I imagine you had a similar experience coming from KKR. It's a different world, and I think, you know, you're an example of what we teach and when we talk about learning agility. But you also had something that I had at that point, which was, you know, situational humility. You might have been comfortable in what you've done in your career, but you need to understand that you're going into an entirely different culture that has a wonderful mission, and your role is to listen and learn for the first 6 months or so, and then perhaps use the wisdom that's been transferred to you to be a better president. So,
did you find any surprises in terms of new leadership muscles you needed to develop when you made the transition from
into the superintendent's
role?
Yeah, it's always humbling, don't you think, what you can learn every day? I think I learned something new every day in that job. But you were doing it with people that were great colleagues, and you loved the mission. But I think the thing that you've probably done, I know you've done, because I've talked to a lot of your people here at Boston University, you show respect for men and women. In return, they respect you enough to give you candid feedback, so that you really are aware what you don't know, what is coming across as good, and maybe that mirror that you look in every morning isn't telling you a couple of things that they are.
Oh, yes.
And then you realize you're blessed. You know, with the Center for Creative Leadership, we have this saying that feedback is a gift. In fact, I have a chair in my office that is called the gift chair, and I think that anybody that sits in there, I'm expecting them to give me honest, straight feedback, the gift, and that's been beneficial. Yeah.
So is that one of your primary ways of getting feedback, is to ask people to sit in the chair, if you will, and provide feedback? Or how are you developing, as you help develop leaders, and the part of it, a big piece of this is giving and receiving feedback, how do you model that as the CEO of a great institution like the Center for Creative Leadership?
Probably the same way you do, Ken. You make people feel comfortable, and you let them know that you respect them and that you know you can learn from them. You know, we both have had different careers before we came into our current positions, but I think you would agree with me that people get themselves in trouble when they think they know it all, or they have an ego that gets in the way, or they just forget that, you know, we all need a sense of humility every single day. You know, I don't need to go to the barbers much, but when I go, I learn something from that woman every time I go. The way she acts, the way she handles herself, it can be inspiring. So I think that's important.
Leadership, the opportunity to learn about leadership, is a 24/7 experience.
It is.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah, it is
now,
amazing.
Now, John, as you've come into the center, you've been doing a lot of thinking about what really leadership for the future, where the leadership's heading as we head to the year 2020 and beyond. Mm-hmm. And my understanding is you've developed some significant principles, some thoughts about several principles that are vital as you look to the future for people to be successful. What might they be?
Well, you're very kind saying that I've thought of them, but, you know, I have 600 men and women and another 600 adjuncts and faculty that are all over the world. And we're a lot like a university in that we're research-based. We're an educational not-for-profit. So we've been doing research on leaders for 42 years. And at first it was just in America, but for the last 25 years it's been all over the world. I'm just back from the Middle East and China. Where, you know, we have research going on right now. But the focus that I was taking when I talked about some practices is we see that there are a number of principles or behaviors that are very important as people want to step on the global stage and think of themselves as becoming global leaders. And you look at the world that you're in and I'm in now, it's one filled with a lot of uncertainty and complexity and ambiguity and volatility, and we're absolutely crazy if we think we can control everything in our organization, make it successful. So we think of about four or five, you know, there are probably more, but we see four or five practices that are very important for all of us, no matter where we are in leadership, to begin developing and using as we go forward. If you want to hear about those, I could. The first one is something that we actually did a lot of research on. It's called boundary spanning. And two of my colleagues, Chris Ernst and Barbara Chapo Mason, who's actually at University of Cincinnati, did research all over the globe on what makes a successful global leader. And they came up with this concept that in this day and age, you need to be able to span boundaries. You had to do that at KKR, you have to do that here. And boundaries, you know, they define as not just the vertical and the horizontal, but stakeholder, geographic, and demographic. And so when you think about it, leaders do need to be able to span those boundaries, and they develop six principles. But the important thing is that we as leaders, we need to do that, and we need to practice these principles. And it's like anything else. You become a great soccer player or musician, by practicing. And so we have methods that we help people practice to do this. But I haven't met anybody that's a global leader. You know, I think of somebody like Mr. Todd or Mr. Mahinder. We work with both of those companies in India. They're great boundary spanners.
And the importance of being able to be aware of and appreciate cultural differences is so very important.
Huge.
In this aspect. And how do you see the ability for people to learn that capability? There's no substitute for doing, of course.
Right, right.
But are there other techniques individuals
sure.
and students
yeah.
can use to understand and gain that appreciation?
Yeah. I think it's just like you look at your own leadership career, Ken. We, again, have done research, I think, for 35 years that says you as a leader, what you know today, 70% you got through experience, whether it's working on a committee, working on a different assignment, et cetera. 20% is from other men and women that you've been privileged to be mentored by, coached by, inspired by, or taught what not to do. And then 10% is what we both do in executive education, which is give people the principles, the practices, the frameworks. And you say, well, if it's only 10%, that can't be too important. Well, you can't stop people from learning every day, nor do you want to, and neither do I, but we'd like them to be learning the right things. And so if you give them the right frameworks and principles to start with, then the experiences they have, they're going to capture more of it, and they're going to capture more from their mentors and coaches. So we think that it's important that you have all those experiences, but then something else, which you have in spades, which is called learning agility.
Okay.
And that's something that we have studied along with other organizations like Lominger. And learning agility is something that's, it's not just our traditional learning that you need, but it's the learning that you get from the experiences you've had, wherever they've been. Whether it's been through a mentor, a coach, working on a committee, a cross-functional team. And this is important because the world you live in today is not the world that you lived in 15 or 20 years ago. It is complex, it is ambiguous, it's uncertain, and you need the traditional learning, but you need to be able to adapt on the fly. And what all our research, we've just done some research with Columbia University, and what that says is, learning agile people, again, are people like yourself. They're people who are willing to do things that they haven't done before. They have this inquisitive nature, this respectful nature about other cultures and people. They're willing to make mistakes, and they accept feedback as something that's going to help them get better. And I'm giving you the shorthand version on this, but essentially, you need both in this world that we're living in now. And the most successful leaders, we've studied this, as I said, for over three decades in two ways. What made these people successful, and why did these people derail? Not necessarily get fired, but they didn't reach their opportunity. And in every case, the successful people have this learning agility where they're willing to put aside the old tried and true solutions and be uncomfortable not knowing what to do, but use the experiences that they've had to come to the right judgments.
John,
this is incredibly important.
And in this context of learning agility, the ability to have at least a level of self-awareness seems mm-hmm. to be a very important aspect, and the center is famous for helping growing executives to learn so much more about who they are and what makes
right.
them tick. How do you see the self-awareness piece of the equation impacting learning agility?
It's very important. It's very important for learning agility and for success. Without it, we're not going to reach our potential. You know, the person that we see every morning when we look in the mirror and shave, or in my case, not comb my hair, that's not the person that everybody else sees. So we developed the first 360s, not for assessment, but for development back in the early 70s. And I'm so proud of the people whose shoulders we now stand on. Of course, lots of people now do 360s, but those are incredibly important for telling you how your bosses, your peers, the people you're privileged to lead, how they see John Ryan every day or Ken Freeman. And we need to do that not just through 360s, but as we were talking before the camera started to roll, we need to give people this sense of we want this kind of feedback. I don't have to ask for it. I need it. Give it to me every day. And I think that's what helps us say, that was good. I can do a little bit more of that, but don't overuse it. But gosh, you need to stop doing this. And the best leaders, and I get to see a lot of the best leaders in the world, they want that feedback. And the ones who derail are the ones who stopped asking for it. They've seen it all, know it all, done it all. Or, even worse, they're surrounded by people who buffer them from the real world, who don't tell them what they need to learn. I was pleased to see, Kathy was telling me before we came here, you didn't take the normal dean's office. You're down in an area where you're in the organization.
I'm in the fishbowl.
You're right in the fishbowl.
Sir. Yes.
This is, you know, we could look at some people that are fabulous people who have failed, or at least for a day failed. You know, somebody like a General Petraeus, who said led a life of integrity every day. And then my, part of my analysis is, had so many buffers around himself that he stopped thinking about serving others and became a little selfish, maybe only for a couple of days, but you know, that can do us all in.
Yeah.
So it's a red flag that any leader ought to be looking for is, you know, are you still part of the organization? Or are you this chancellor that's up in the sky that talks to no one but 20 people who are telling you how great you are every day? Mm. That's danger.
Wow, so spanning boundaries, learning agility,
Self-awareness,
being incredibly accessible important. And transparent.
Yeah, yeah.
What other aspects of leadership for the coming decades do you see as important characteristics for the best leaders that will come forward?
Well, we could talk about, I'd talk about five things, so if I could include two more things, I'd
sure.
say, you know, we all need to be leaders that both inspire innovation and create a culture that allows creativity. Now, that's easy to talk about. I don't mean any deans or presidents of universities or CEOs who say they don't want more innovation or creativity. But I like this, there's this cartoon that you see occasionally associated with innovation where you have like five people that they're around the tree. They're all facing away from one another. They have their hands tied behind their back. And they've got the CEO, me, saying, okay, now, darn it, be innovative. And I think it's a, I have that, incidentally, on the door of my refrigerator in my house to remind me that, you know, we just don't call for creativity or innovation. We have to be leaders for innovation, and we have to establish a culture for innovation. This is very important for global leaders. And we see the people that do this very well. And we see other people who talk about it, but still are punishing people for failure, not removing the impediments that people have that would give them the chance to be more creative. It's easy to talk about, but you know, it's like, I think it was Yogi Berra or Casey Stengel who used to say, you know, you can walk into a locker room and feel the culture of the baseball team. And you know, after 5 years in this job, I can spend like 2 or 3 days in an organization, and you know whether they have leaders, not just at the top, but throughout the organization, Ken, that are creating this culture where creativity is something that's accepted, respected, and it's not just five gurus that you've put in an innovation incubator. It's the whole organization. Everybody feels like it's part of their job.
So how does a leader create that culture? There's so many people that have studied and mm-hmm. struggled, frankly,
yeah.
with the aspect of
yeah.
going into an organization that has a set culture
right.
and knowing the change is needed and driving change and leading
yeah.
change is such a
yeah.
very important part for, a,
yeah.
for an executive to
yeah.
do. What are some of the tools that you see that are most successful in helping to drive an organization to, in a way, be reborn, to go
yeah.
to the next level?
Yeah. Well, I think you probably do this very well from what I can see, this spending some time with your faculty and students earlier today. It's kind of like what you do in change management, but it starts with not just the CEO, it's with all the leaders in the organization understanding just how crucial it is for the sustainability of the organization that you have this creative, innovative culture. And then there are some very real practices that start with the CEO, and we kind of ticked off a couple of those. It's, you know, it's establishing that we have goals for the organization around creativity and innovation, but we're going to remove, you've got to find out from the frontline people, what are the impediments? You know, what's keeping us? Who are the, you know, sometimes there's some bad news here too. There are men and women who just like the status quo, and they're not your leaders for the future. You know, you need men and women that are encouraging all kinds of experimentation and are willing to accept failure when it's failure that's been thought out, you know, because of consequences, something happens and something fails. We see organizations that are doing this really, really well. Everybody wants that, but it starts with the right kind of leadership, not just at the CEO. If you go to a place that has a lot of creativity, they have leaders up and down the organization that feel like, this is my job. It's not the CEO's job. It's not the innovation incubator. And we really have six or seven principles that we suggest to our clients. They're no different than what you teach in your MBA programs, but you know, it's about execution when it comes down to it. Is this what we're going to hold people accountable for? Yeah, we want them to have a culture of innovation and creativity. So there's one other thing that I think, you know, it's how we are measured. It's how you're measured as the dean. It's how I'm measured as the CEO of the center. It's, you know, the judgments we make. When you get right down to it, every place you've been evaluated on the judgments you make. And there's a great book called Judgment that's been out now like for 5 years by two great
Warren
people.
Bennis.
Warren Bennis and Noel. And, Noel. And, you know, they talk about it in their book, but I like the way they frame it. And I think, you know, you and I have had experience around this. The most important judgments we make as leaders, whether it's at the local, regional, or global level, it's about people. When you think about it, you can't execute a strategy or deal with a crisis if you don't have the right talent. I'm always humbled by just how tough it is to decide who it is that you want to hire. And we, you know and I know that talent has opportunities. You know, they, when you come with women and men, you're interviewing women and men that are incredibly talented. You have a choice, but they have a choice. Do they want to join the culture that you've established here as dean? I think so. And that's what I worry most about at the Center for Creative Leadership. But we've gone to a style where we're almost like, I think it's Whole Foods that has people that are going to be your colleagues really looking and seeing. It's not just are they smart enough, are they learning agile, but are they going to be a cultural fit? Now, we want mavericks, but you know, we also want people to come in and they're going to enjoy working. They're going to feel engaged at Boston University or the Center for Creative Leadership. So quite often, we don't want to hire someone that's going to turn out to be unhappy. But we also like to have people that are cognitively diverse. So it's a humbling thing, but the judgments that leaders make and at all levels of an organization about the talent that they're going to put in their organization, bring into their, it's the most important thing we do.
Are there companies or specific leaders that you think, maybe we should stick to the company's perspective, company cultures where you see their ability to develop strong leaders as being a profound competitive advantage?
Yeah. People that we worked with, people will get mad if I don't mention them all, but let me just mention one that we worked with up here and it had a big meeting in Boston about 2 years ago, Procter & Gamble. You know, the CEO wanted to continue to work on his matrix organization. He brought in 39 of his top people. I think they're all presidents or CEOs of the great companies. And, you know, you could just see in that room that every one of these men and women own Procter & Gamble. They weren't renters. You know what I mean? They felt like they were owners. And this is something that we look for in people, and the best organizations look for in people. They're not just people that are passing through. Now, they might not have a full career there, but for every day, every hour that they're in the organization, they're engaged. I think that's so important. And the reason why they're engaged is they've been treated well. They've been told you're important, and it's not just in how you're recognized with salary and benefits, it's we're going to invest in you. Just like you have in your career, investing in people. You could see that Procter & Gamble people feel like I've been invested in. People respect me. They see me as someone with potential, and they want that potential to be drawn out. We work with 2,000 companies a year. All of them are trying to do that. That's why they're spending money on, you know, not just their top people, but people who are initial leaders, middle management, top people. That stands out in the best companies. But I could name companies around the world that are doing that.
Wow, yeah. That's wonderful. John, I'm sure a number of students are watching this video and thinking about the impact they're going to have in the world, their opportunity to create value for the world as leaders moving forward. Yeah. Any final words of advice or counsel for this next generation of students that are in their early 20s, late 20s, as they pursue their dreams and hopefully will make a big difference for all of us?
Thanks for that question. Can I tell a story about
Please.
This? So I'm the president of the Naval Academy, and you know I want to make sure that we're admitting the right type of students. So at the end of their summer transition, you get all 1,200 in an auditorium, ask them a couple questions, and say, how many of you want to be pilots? How many want to be in submarines? How many want to be in the Marine Corps? How many of you want to be SEALs? And then my last question is, how many of you want to be leaders? And either every hand goes up, both hands go up, or the men and women stand up. You know, they've recruited themselves. Mm-hmm. At the age of 17, they're thinking of themselves as leaders. I've had the privilege to lead other universities, and I tried to be lazy and use the same analogy. How many want to be doctors, lawyers? And it's disappointing to me because it might be a 5,000 student body freshman class. So you have them in sections of four, and you ask that question at the end, and you know, maybe 15% raise their hand. And then they look around and another 5% raise their hand. I would just encourage everybody that might watch this that's a young person to begin thinking of themselves as a leader today. And think of leaders as people who help other men and women reach their potential. We need more of those.
Yes, we sure do.
And the earlier you start, the better off you're going to be.
Well, gosh, John, thank you so very much. We've been speaking with John Ryan, President and CEO of the Center for Creative Leadership. We thank him for sharing his words of wisdom about the future of leadership. Thank you so very much, John.
Thank
it's
you,
been
Ken.
Wonderful.
Thank you, Ken.